So we have seats for latecomers, which even now are being filled in. Thank you all for being so cooperative. I'm Dr. Delaney, and I would like to introduce you to the Paul C. Wilt Phi Kappa Phi Faculty Lectureship. And I'd like to introduce what may be the most global year in the Phi Kappa Phi Lectureship series. I would invite you to return next spring for the lecture by Dr. Cynthia Toms on Ethical International Volunteerism and Service, Moral Responsibility, Are More Harm Than Good. But tonight, we get to hear Dr. Heather Keaney deliver an address on Tyrants, Terrorists, and Tropes in Islamic History. Just to give you a word about the format of the evening, we will have the lecture by Dr. Keaney, then we will have two respondents. She will have the opportunity to respond to her respondents, and then we'll throw the door open, the floor open for questions and discussion. We hope we get all of that. Dr. Keaney graduated from Westmont, received her MA and PhD degree from UCSB. Her book, Medieval Islamic Historiography, Remembering Rebellion, traces the depictions of the first Islamic civil war in accounts that span from the 9th to the 14th centuries. In that, she raises questions about the existence of, about the extent to which the communities felt that it was appropriate to respond to an unjust leader and revolt against that, or to the extent to which the need for unity within the community forbade responses to an unjust leader. So does community or justice loom larger? Before we get into the lecture, could I ask those of you in front of the doors to open the doors? It's going to get warm in here. It should be possible to both open both of them by adjusting. There you go. Thank you so much. Dr. Keaney is the co-founder and the co-leader of Westmont in Istanbul, a program that has not just been eye-opening but transformative for many students who have participated. We are delighted to have her in the community, and we're delighted to hear her address tonight. Dr. Keaney.
Hello. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Right. I thought I should start out in light of the advertisements that have surrounded this lecture by stating what it is and what it is not. So I am not going to explain for you all the ascent and actions of ISIS, though I suspect that's very quickly where our Q&A time will go, and I'm happy to discuss it. So what I would like to say is that my paper is to help inform that inevitable discussion. I am a historian, and what I want to discuss today are the rhetorical and historical frames that contemporary would-be tyrants, would-be non-tyrants, would-be rebels who are called terrorists refer to. So I'm going to do in the first half of the paper, I'm going to look at that medieval framing and some of the key paradigmatic historical events that continue to have relevance and valency for actors today, and then look at how those have been reinterpreted in the modern period with the rise of Islamist movements in the 20th century and the Arab Spring in 2011. So kind of half medieval, half modern, and as we triangulate between those three, I think we're then in a good place to continue to engage with contemporary events. So that's the plan. The inspiration for this talk actually came with headlines when I was in Egypt in June of this past summer, at which point it was announced that the former president, I bring this up, Mohamed Morsi, had been sentenced to death by the Egyptian Supreme Court. Mohamed Morsi is the Muslim Brotherhood political candidate who became president in 2012, but was overthrown in 2013. So what was his crime that got him the death sentence? He was accused of being a part of a Muslim Brotherhood jailbreak during the revolt against President Mubarak during the Arab Spring of 2011. And he was also accused of supporting murder by his supporters as they resisted the counter coup that brought down Morsi in the summer of 2013. In order for there to be a death sentence in Egypt, capital punishment, al-Azhar, the religious establishment, has to support that verdict of capital punishment. Al-Azhar, which is the center not only of religious learning in Egypt, but of the Sunni world globally, duly complied and supported the guilty verdict and death sentence on the basis that Morsi was guilty of something called haraba. What you ask is haraba. Let me explain. Haraba comes from a Quranic verse, the so-called, wait for it, haraba verse, which states the following. The punishment for those who wage war against God and his prophet and perpetrate disorder in the land is to kill or hang them, or have a hand on one side and a foot on the other cut off, or banish them from the land. Such is their disgrace in the world and in the hereafter, their doom shall be dreadful. But those who repent before they are subdued should know that God is forgiving and kind. Now, medieval Islamic jurists took this verse and tried to then unpack what constitutes war against God and spreading disorder in the land. And they focused on activities that spread a sense of terror, vulnerability, and chaos. The modern American Muslim scholar Sherman Jackson has concluded that the medieval understanding of haraba is very similar to our modern understandings of terrorism, with this focus on spreading terror and fear and a sense of general vulnerability. In the medieval context, examples would be attacking trade so that this brings the wheels of commerce to a halt and all merchants feel threatened. Or if somebody attacks a minority because they are a minority, then all members of that minority feel threatened. So it's that indiscriminate sense of terror which constitutes haraba or brings kind of, again, general chaos. This is what they're accusing Morsi of, and as you can see, it brings with it, according to the Quran, not only capital punishment, but actually the harshest form of punishment that the Quran prescribes. However, medieval Islamic jurists made a distinction between haraba and something known as baghi, because there's an important way in which haraba is different from modern American understandings of terrorism. Listen closely. If your act of violence is directed against the government, if it's politically motivated, if you have a large number of supporters, directed against the government, large number of supporters, and you have a religious justification for your acts of violence, then you are not guilty of haraba. In that sense, it's actually the direct inverse of American understandings of terrorism. If you are politically motivated, have a large number of supporters, and have a religious justification, you are guilty of baghi, which comes from the baghi verse, which is as follows. If two groups of believers come to fight one another, promote peace between them, then if one of them turns aggressive against the other, fight against the aggressive party till it returns to God's authority. If it does so, make peace among them equitably and be impartial. Verily, God loves those who are just. Medieval jurists, through this verse, are effectively providing legal protection for political rebels. And they're distinguishing political acts of opposition and trying to protect them from being accused of terrorism, bringing chaos. If you are accused of bari, notice there is no, what is the punishment for bari? What jurists concluded is that there is no punishment. So a medieval political rebel, while the government is justified in crushing a rebellion, they cannot do anything to the rebels themselves. They shouldn't be punished or tortured. In fact, they should be released unpunished. Any damage to property, they're not responsible for. Any property that they themselves lose should be restored to them. Some would argue it's a quite modern, enlightened protection for legal opposition, dissent, and speech. So, but this is not what Morsi was accused of. He was accused of haraba and chaos, not political opposition. I want to kind of move from this kind of medieval understanding to how we get to a modern understanding in this context over who is the terrorist and who is the tyrant. Who can be guilty of bari and who can be guilty of haraba? And I'll continue to refer to these terms so they will become as familiar to you as they are to me. Don't worry. As you can see from this Bari verse, that Islamic law is jurists' law. It is developed by legal scholars, not state officials. And in fact, those legal scholars are frequently functioning in a conscious opposition to the state to restrict and limit abuses by the state. And we see in jurists an awareness of political abuse and a desire to try to restrict or limit it. But it's not, clearly this is not a verse defending rebellion per se, right? It's defending rebels. So jurists are also having to wrestle with the desire for strong and stable government. So how do you protect opposition without having a free-for-all and political chaos that makes it impossible for a government to go about its business, secure trade routes, defend borders, etc. This is what medieval jurists are trying to decide. There's also a clear indication that despite these kind of distinctions between bari and haraba, there's also the same vulnerability that we see in the modern period in which one person's terrorist is another person's freedom fighter. There are distinctions, but it can be very easy for somebody who's engaging in political rebellion, if that political rebellion can be seen as causing more widespread chaos, have they tipped over into terrorism? They're no longer a rebel, they're a terrorist. Okay? So how did jurists and medieval Muslims negotiate this tension? What helped them negotiate appeals to stability and appeals to justice? Appeals to support the government so it can go about its job, but limit its likely abuses. One of the things that informed that discussion, and what I would like to argue was most critical to informing that discussion, is not Quranic verses, but the historical context in which those Quranic verses are interpreted and applied. I'm a historian after all, so there should be no surprise in that statement. In particular, there is a significant, the first rebellion against a Muslim ruler sets the frame, sets the terms of the debate in which all subsequent rebellions are going to be understood, irregardless of bari and haraba. So I want to talk about that original first rebellion and the narratives and paradigms that emerged from it and the ways that those endure into the present. Okay? So that rebellion is known as the first fitna, and fitna is a fabulous Arabic word. Women cause fitna when they walk into a room, but fitna generally means chaos, but also schism, civil war, general mayhem. Okay, this is fitna. And the first rebellion by Muslims against a Muslim ruler did not become classified as rebellion, but it became known as the first fitna. And that's important because that's going to then color all subsequent rebellions. Are they potentially fitna? So, this rebellion took place against the third caliph or successor to Muhammad, a guy named Uthman ibn Affan. And he was accused of abuses of power, nepotism, appointing family members, using the public treasury for his own uses, lining his own pocket, effectively. And during his reign, opposition grew, frustration grew with what seemed as a divergence from a more austere and pietistic model by Muhammad and Uthman's, the first two caliphs, his two predecessors. So, ultimately, rebels gathered in Medina to confront Uthman with his abuses. He refused to change his ways. In fact, some accounts describe him as seeming to appease the besiegers, the rebels, promising to change, all the while secretly gathering weapons and gathering support so that when they had turned their back, he could pounce on them. So we have general oppression and then duplicity. Also, some accounts talk about people who came to Uthman to criticize about his abuses. Not only did he not listen to them, he had them whipped or tortured. So there's this sense of Uthman starting out nepotistic and becoming increasingly authoritarian and abusive, so that he is ultimately besieged in his home. And I just want to, just because I like it, read a description of his murder. So, this is from a medieval biography. The attackers entered his room and one stabbed him in the face with a stake. And Uthman said, "In the name of God, I put my trust in him." And then the blood flowed down onto his beard and trickled onto the Quran that was between his hands. For he had been reading the Quran and saying, "Praise God, the Almighty." When the blood flowed onto the Quran and gurgled up and stopped his speech. Then the Quran closed and together they struck him as a group. God have mercy upon him. So you can imagine why this would become kind of a trope, a paradigm, an image that is continually going to be referred back to, where this person who's the third caliph after Muhammad, we're talking 25 years after Muhammad died. We are still in the afterglow of the prophetic age. He's also an early convert, close companion, and then to be accused of rebellion and then brutally murdered, this like shakes the Islamic project to its core. Indeed, there are a couple different copies of the supposed Quran that he was reading. This one's from Kappa Palace in Istanbul, but I think there's also one in Tashkent. So he was only reading one, but you know, relics, they have a way of multiplying. So Uthman, this in his murder and what this meant for the community, not only was it the causes and the actual event of the rebellion and this idea of murdering a companion, Muslims murdering a Muslim ruler, but the long-term consequences of the rebellion also, they're huge. So let me just say what those are. The rebellion leads to the caliphate becoming increasingly hereditary kinship, hereditary succession, far removed from any kind of Islamic model of justice or ruling based on piety or closeness to Muhammad or religious character. You inherit kingship from your father like all the other kings in the surrounding region. The murder of Uthman kind of sets things in that trajectory. Moreover, the revolt against Uthman permanently divides the Muslim community. Some people in the community think they need to attack then Uthman's attackers. Other people say, actually, they had a point. Why just continue the bloodshed? This division leads to the split between Sunni and Shia Islam, in which the defenders of Uthman, wait for it, for the sake of the unity of the community, become the foundation for Sunni Islam. Whereas those who opposed and criticized Uthman, and people who defend that position, become Shia Islam. The idea that you can resist a ruler, a Pahlavi, for the sake of establishing a better, just order. And these two are going to feed off of each other. Shia opposition and continued pursuit of overthrowing a ruler to achieve something better is going to force Sunnis to effectively circle the wagons, entrench, and hold on even more tightly to a unity position. They define each other. So when we look at the modern Middle East today, we want to be keeping that in mind. There is this deep identity within Sunni Islam that you hold on to the unity of the community, even in the face of tyranny. Okay, so we have this medieval paradigm. You're with me. Okay. In the narratives of Uthman's murder, this is more fully fleshed out in Sunni chronicles and biographies. They recognize what this means, and so they want to, maybe somewhat like, I shouldn't say this, I don't know Greek history, but create the ideal thing that Uthman would have said in his defense, and the ideal thing that his besiegers would have said in their defense. And we find these in particular in the 9th century chronicles, where the kind of definitive narrative is set. So I want to kind of unpack those narratives, because those are also going to inform the tropes, the terms that subsequent rebels and rulers can appeal to. So in the case of Uthman, he defends himself, or the chroniclers defend him, I guess we should say more honestly. They don't deny that he committed abuses. There's not a sense of, no, just, I'm not a tyrant. I'm really pious. There's some of that. But what there really is again, this defense for the unity of the community. So what they argue is that Uthman achieved his position of authority through an oath of allegiance. He was chosen to be caliph by the community. And at that point, people swore an oath of allegiance to him. That oath of allegiance is binding. So again, this idea that once you become ruler, you are the legitimate ruler. Succession confers legitimacy, is really important. The second thing is that they argued that that the succession issues, but also these appeals to unity, they argue that God was not asleep on the job. So when Uthman was chosen, God knew. And God is outside time. So God knew what Uthman was going to do. And yet he let him be chosen anyway. Therefore, this must all be a part of God's will. Which is a very hard political argument to work against, right? Every ruler is, by definition, God's choice. But we hear that in American political discourse, I think. So maybe it's not that strange. So, but again, it's really hard to fight against. And in Islamic discourse, the language is that God placed a cloak of authority upon Uthman, and Uthman cannot remove it. And again, similarly, every ruler has a cloak of authority placed upon him, and he cannot remove it. So he cannot step down, he cannot be overthrown. Similarly, the narratives are replete with appeals to unity. The idea that if you try to forcefully remove this cloak of authority, God will strike you down with the punishment of fitna, disunity, chaos, civil war, schism, which again, you can see how these narratives are reflecting what actually happened, but they become the definitive narratives that this is the consequence of rebellion, going against God's chosen. But there are, and I also wanted to say that these are not defense of tyranny. These are defenses for unity. And that's an important point, that people recognize that these are tyrants. It's not ideal, but the appeal and principle of unity and what can be achieved with a unified, strong government kind of overrides other concerns. But there are minority reports, if you will, Tom Cruise aside, that one we see in the Berri, this idea of trying to protect political speech, making that effort to, again, not allow tyrants to just kind of crush everybody. You also see in the narratives the rebels' rebuttal to Uthman, in which they argue, yes, God allowed you to be appointed, but you are now a test from God of how faithful are we going to be to the Islamic call to justice. You have brought in innovation. You have become a corrupt. You have forfeited your legitimacy. And God is testing us about whether we're going to call you on that. They also point out that it's not right to not pursue justice out of some fear of possible fitna in the future. That's not a good enough reason to abandon all pursuits for justice. So there is this counter narrative, which is going to be picked up by modern reformers. This minority report, this ability to say the tyrant is not legitimate just because they happen to be in power, and that Islam calls us to fight for justice. Okay, in terms of where we are so far, Haraba Baghi appeals to unity and appeals to justice. Okay. Before turning to the modern period, I want to raise an important thing there that kind of secures the unity position for Sunni Islam. Three divisions take place within the medieval period that kind of, it's not as if time stops in the 9th century, but developments in the three developments in the 10th century really solidify even further this 9th century paradigm. The first is the continued and ultimately permanent division between Sunni and Shia Islam, in which Shia Islam seems an existential threat to Sunnis, so that any rebellion or opposition to the government can be accused of or associated with Shiism, which again can bolster the status quo security position, because Shiism, this is, you know, riven the community in part, turned it in on itself, weakened its presence in the world, should not be tolerated. So this Shi'i threat further strengthens the unity position. The other medieval division, particularly kind of solidifying in the 10th century, is a division between religious and political authority. And I know we tend to think of Islam as religion and politics combined, but to some extent that's a modern Islamist fantasy. That within medieval Islam, there is a clear division of authority. The ruler is not a religious scholar. They cannot speak for Islam. They do not interpret the Quran. The jurists do. And as we've seen, the jurists often function in opposition to the state, trying to limit the state. So this division between religious and political authority also strengthens the unity position with the idea that that's the government's job. The government's job is to defend borders and secure the unity of the empire. And within that, it's the jurists and the scholars and the preachers who deliver justice to people in their daily lives. Does that make sense? Okay? The third division is actually a literary division in which these 9th century biographies and chronicles, which are debating unity and justice, rebellion versus terrorism, what is legitimate, subsequent centuries, historians and chroniclers turn to dynastic histories, regional histories. They actually don't write histories of the early Islamic period. They feel that the 9th century narratives are comprehensive, and they turn their attention elsewhere. Instead, which doesn't mean people don't write about the early Islamic period. They do, but they do it not through histories and chronicles that are debating religious and political principles. They do it through hagiography. So if you're not familiar, hagiography, sanctified, sterilized biographies, which are not meant, well, I'm revealing my modern prejudices. Sanctified, sterilized biographies, which are not meant to reveal the inner workings of the character or talk about historical causation, but to show an individual as an ideal type. So this is what happens with early Islamic characters like Uthman. There are no longer many histories about him as a caliph. Instead, we get these hagiographies of him as a companion that say virtually nothing about his caliphate. But that's just one example. The whole early Islamic period ironically becomes depoliticized in the later medieval period. Okay, modern period with me. I want to look at how these kind of set understandings are then reinterpreted, in some senses cracked open by modern developments, and in other ways prove remarkably resilient. Okay, so in terms of being, I want to look at two things. One, the rise of Islamist parties in the mid-20th century, and then the Arab Spring in 2011. So in terms of modern Islamist parties, the turn to what we call Islamism or political Islam is in and of itself a response to modern developments. One is the role of governments in replacing Islamic law with imported legal codes from Europe. This, in a sense, renegotiates the medieval paradigm that the ruler achieves unity, but the scholars achieve justice through Islamic law. Well, if the ruler starts impinging on Islamic law with imported codes from Switzerland or France, then they're changing the terms of the agreement. The other thing that happens is that the state starts to expand its reach. I mean, in the medieval period, I mean, what was the reach into people's daily lives of the central government in Baghdad or Istanbul? But in the modern state, the government is in your face. So if that modern government is tyrannical or oppressive, that means something different, and that political reach is going to elicit a political response, political Islam, which is going to have to reconsider this traditional unity versus justice paradigm. So the main person who first kind of cracked this open in the 1960s is Sayyid Qutb. How many here have heard of Sayyid Qutb? Okay. Very good. So Sayyid Qutb is Egyptian. He is the ideologue of the Muslim Brotherhood in the 1960s and is generally regarded as the father of modern jihadi thought. Okay? Qutb argued that, let's just take this idea of the legitimate government is the government that's in power off the table. That the legitimate Muslim government is the one that is enforcing and supporting Islamic law. That is the measure. So according to Qutb, who is not a religious scholar, which frees him from the confines of the medieval debate, but doesn't prevent him from writing a Quranic commentary, writes a Quranic commentary in which he looks at the Haraba verse and says, Haraba is organized rebellion against legitimate Islamic authority. But it is the government that is guilty of organized opposition to those like the Muslim Brotherhood that are calling for Islamic law. They, not only are they not tyrant, not only are they not terrorists, the Muslim Brotherhood, they're not even rebels. They're the legitimate Muslim authority. Flipping that on its head, the government, according to Qutb, it's not that they're bad rulers or tyrannical Muslims. He argues that because they're not pursuing Islamic law and supporting Islamic rule, they're not Muslims at all. And he uses the word to describe Egypt, jahiliya, which means pre-Islamic Arabia. So Egypt is so un-Islamic, it's like Arabia before Muhammad even showed up. In which case, again, the ruler is not a bad Muslim, the ruler is a non-Muslim, which means he can be opposed, resisted, and killed. Completely kind of switching the paradigm. This is what Qutb did. Not surprisingly, he was arrested and executed by the Egyptian government in 1966. Okay? But that's not the end. The legacy of Qutb endures. The Muslim Brotherhood itself steps back and says, okay, this is not a good strategy. From prison, because they're all in prison, they argue that we are not called to to be judges of men's souls and decide who is or is not a Muslim. We're called to preach the truth. And they issue a document, preachers, not judges. They also encourage jihad of the pen rather than jihad of the sword. Preach, teach, write, prepare the way for the full implementation of God's justice through Islamic law. So this is what the Muslim Brotherhood does. They step back, and eventually they choose to participate in parliamentary politics under the political platform Islam Hoa al-Hal. Islam is the solution. It's almost as good as yes, we can, right? I mean, you can't argue with Islam. You cannot in the Muslim world say Islam is not the solution. So it's guaranteed. So the Muslim Brotherhood pulls back, but other jihadi groups claim to be the true heirs of Qutb and the true heirs of Muhammad, including a group called Al-Jihad, as a matter of fact. And they continue to carry out acts of terrorism against the government, culminating in 1981 with the assassination of Sadat, who was in the grandstands looking at a military parade. And this jihadi group had infiltrated the military, burst out of their tank with a machine gun, and gunned him down on live television. 1981. The violent resistance to the regime continued, though, under Sadat's successor, Mubarak. And through the 80s and 90s, you had practically a civil war in Egypt between these jihadi groups and the states. All the while, this is the Muslim Brotherhood with their slogan, Al-Islam Hawa'i Ha, on the bottom. So you've got two different kind of models, jihadis, Islamists, and they're not the same. So that would be one thing to keep in mind. At one level, maybe all jihadis are Islamists, but not all Islamists are jihadis. So while the Muslim Brotherhood adopts politics, other groups continue to engage in armed resistance. Coming to a tragic crescendo in November of 1997, when another jihadi group opened fire on a group of tourists as they were disembarking from their bus at the Hatshepsut Temple in Upper Egypt. Gunned them down. They were in the cliffs, kind of attacked first thing in the morning, and I believe over 20 people, European tourists, were killed. The Egyptian public outcry of disgust and dismay that, okay, we have been tolerating this conflict between the Islamists on the one hand or the jihadis on the one hand and the government on the other has just gone too far. And again, the groups were not attacking these tourists because they have a problem with tourists per se, but they're wanting to cause a tourist to not come to Egypt, loss of foreign currency, weaken government, Islamist takeover. So that's the logic there, is how tourists became targets. With this public outcry in 1997, the leaders of, again, these groups that have continued to be involved in violent opposition, again, pull back from violence, again, from prison, renounce violence. And there hasn't been organized Islamist jihadi violence in Egypt since 1997 of any significant kind. It's all been through the Muslim Brotherhood, political participation, evolution rather than revolution. I think it's worth noting that so the ways in which the Islamist groups, again, we see how Qutb tries to reinterpret the medieval understanding of who is the terrorist. The ruler can effectively be the terrorist, and the terrorists are the legitimate government. It also complete disregard for the medieval jurists concerned with the unity of the community. They are trying to unleash civil war. They are trying to destabilize the government. As a consequence, the government brings, declarations of fitna down upon them. You do not deserve any respect. Your complaints or your criticisms of the government are not worth listening to. And ironically, it strengthens the tyranny of the regime because they can say, look, it's our tyranny or it's their chaos. And it almost gives the kind of tyrannical position a new lease on life. In many ways, totally backfires. The other thing is that the religious establishment does not support these groups, al-Azhar. They remain faithful to their unity position that they have developed. And I mean, they're establishment figures. They're conservative. This is not how they want things done. Also, if the Islamists are right and take over government, and they have the ability, like Sayyid Qutb, to pick up the Quran and say what it means, what happens to all the jurists who've dedicated their life studying Hadith and Quran? They're out of a job. So there's real questions in terms of this establishment support for Islamists, which really weakens their effectiveness. And I'd like to point out that no Sunni Islamist group has successfully toppled a modern dictator. Iran is Shia, and Shia are on the side of the opponents of Uthman. Islamist groups in the Sunni world, by and large, have not had the support of the religious establishment, which makes their claims of fighting for justice against oppression ring hollow. They don't get the full kind of stamp of Islamic approval. Okay? It endures. The group that has been successful in overthrowing modern dictators in the Sunni world is not Islamist groups, but globalized youth using social media. Toppled many dictators, as a matter of fact. So this image, which you've seen around campus, is a portrayal. Khalid Said is the kid in the sweatshirt, and the person he is holding up is Hosni Mubarak, the president of Egypt since 1981, with the assassination of Sadat. Khalid Said, in the summer of 2010, was brutally murdered in police custody. He was arrested, killed. The family demanded to see his body. Eventually, was released to them mutilated, clearly tortured. But what the family did is post pictures of his mutilated face on social media. And this guy, Wael Ghanim, who is the Google representative for the Middle East, created a Facebook page, "We Are All Khalid Said," in the summer of 2010. And this Facebook page became a platform for opposition to tyrannical rule, youth who were saying, we reject the framing that our only choice is tyranny or terrorism. There is another way. We refute that narrative from the state. The movement through social media in opposition and growing frustration with the government came to a head in January 25th, 2011, which is why you have the hashtag January 25th. And this is, again, a reference to Twitter and the role of social media in the Arab Spring. January 25th, the Egyptian government decided to declare a new national holiday, Police Day, to celebrate the faithful service of the police services, to which the people of Egypt said, "You gotta be kidding me," and called on people through social media, use this holiday to come out and demonstrate. And this launched in Egypt what became known as the January 25th revolution, which 18 days later successfully toppled Mubarak, who had been in power for 30 years. What gave this group momentum? One of the things is their policies gave them the ability to negotiate this Baghi-Haraba divide. They did not engage in violence. They emphatically argued for nonviolence, popular resistance. That was critical, that they're not bringing dissension. They're not bringing chaos. Also, social media made the thing go so quickly, 18 days after 30 years, that there wasn't time for there to be a sense that this is tearing the country apart, we're descending into chaos. Also, the protesters in places like Tahrir Square did not descend into sectarianism, but instead embraced and espoused a national solidarity between Christians and Muslims that argued, we are the true defenders of the unity of the community. We are the true nationalists, And it's the tyrannical government that's trying to split us apart for its own nefarious purposes. Nevertheless, al-Azhar continued to oppose the demonstrators, as did the government, using the same arguments that we see from the revolt against Uthman. To rebel against the legitimate ruler is fitna. God is going to punish you. Just wait and see. And statements were made by al-Azhar exactly to that effect, saying, you know, fitna is asleep. God damns the group that awakens it, i.e. you, youth in the street. To rebel against the legitimate ruler is haram, haram, haram. Forbidden, forbidden, forbidden. And they quote Quranic verses calling for obeying the legitimate authority. So Azhar is firmly on the side of the regime. Until the regime is no more and is successfully toppled. Then we see Azhar quickly reassess the situation. And this is where I want to, my last point is because, again, I want to show the ways in which this Haraba Belhi paradigm can be reinterpreted and the ways in which this unity justice paradigm, while constraining in some ways political action, is open always to reinterpretation. So Mubarak is toppled in February. In the fall of 2011, Azhar comes out with a statement in defense of the revolution. And I'm going to give you some quotes. And the reason I am putting these up kind of in there in big chunks is because I just love the language and the evidence of reinterpreting the tradition. So according to Azhar, the practice of many rulers with aspirations to absolute power is to cling to the incorrect understanding of the Quranic verse, calling for obedience to authority, by ignoring the previous verse, which says, verily Allah commands you to render back to the trust in your due, and when you judge between people, to judge with justice. And they argue the reason Azhar defended the regime is not because they have a love affair with tyranny, but because they're afraid of chaos. But it has also allowed the ousting of the tyrannical oppressor at the bottom. If the people have the ability to achieve this, and if there's no possibility of damage or harm to the nation. So again, if you can overthrow the government without schism, without civil war, without chaos, good luck. But if you can, then there are resources for you in the tradition. You can be engaged in Belhi rather than Haraba. Okay, and the account goes on to defend this and condemn the rulers, but try to strike this balance between, yes, we want justice, yes, we want democracy, but as long as it doesn't sacrifice unity and stability. How am I doing for time? I think I'm quite long, yeah?
45 minutes.
Okay, thank you. So I won't unpack this whole document. Let me just say it does this backing and forthing. But what it ultimately says is it issues, in a sense, also it argues that the government became illegitimate, the Mubarak government became illegitimate when it shot demonstrators, which is a very convenient ignoring of the 30 years of people dying in police custody. Somehow these murders made the government illegitimate. But that's what they argue. But they also strike a warning saying, yes, new reformers and revolutionaries, you know, God bless you, good luck. But if you lead, your actions lead to denominationalism or sectarianism, or if you get outside backing, meaning you somehow undermine national sovereignty, then we've got no support for you. You have crossed over and have become rebels, traitors to the nation. Okay, so this is this kind of, you're a freedom fighter, you're a human rights activist, but if you lead to sectarianism, you can become a rebel and can be resisted. I want to get us back to Morsi, however. The coalition that brought down Mubarak quickly dissolved for lack of a clear vision for the future and leadership. And who benefited from that was the Muslim Brotherhood. They had not sparked the uprisings, they had not initiated them, but they were the established opposition organized group. And this is how Mohamed Morsi was elected president in 2012, the first democratically elected president in Egypt, who was overthrown a year later. In part because the Muslim Brotherhood didn't listen to the warnings of al-Azhar. They didn't pursue national unity. They continued to pursue the interests of the Muslim Brotherhood over the seeming interests of Egypt, which opened the door for both the military, with the support of al-Azhar, to say, you're illegitimate. You are threatening Haraba. You are dividing the country along Muslim Christian lines, for example. You are more interested in the global Islamist movement rather than Egypt. All of these things make you suspect. And this is how Morsi is overthrown, and this contributes to the verdict of Haraba against him, which ironically, it was Sayyid Qutb and his reinterpretation of Haraba who made that verdict possible. I think that's called irony. In conclusion, let me return to what I am saying and what I am not saying. I'm not defending terrorist acts, nor am I I'm not defending terrorism, nor am I wanting to defend tyranny, nor am I wanting to feed into dictators in the region who would argue that this is the only choice. That's not what I'm saying. What I'm trying to say, hope I've said, is that these medieval paradigms create a narrative and frame the choices, but that that narrative is in a process of constant translation. And I'm hoping to, I've conveyed to you some of the grammar that's involved in translating that into the modern period. I also am not trying to engage in an Orientalist frame that says medieval 9th century events predetermine current events, as if there's no kind of living history, which is one of the reasons why I have the quote from al-Azhar, because I think it illustrates, no, this is a dynamic and living tradition. Instead, I want to suggest that the unity and justice paradigm functions a little bit like liberty, equality, and fraternity in the French Revolution and in the Western political tradition, where liberty, equality, and fraternity are nice ideals, they sound good together, but in practice, are hard to achieve, right? My freedom to swing my arm stops at your right to your nose. So modern governments in the West, this is what we're involved in. This is our political project. How do we reconcile liberty and equality? I'd like to argue that for the Muslim world, there's a similar tension, but it's framed between unity and justice. How do we maximize justice without sacrificing unity? So I don't want us to sit back as kind of with a smug, superior attitude that we've got it figured out. I'd like us to be aware of our own political debates, but I'd also like us to extend sympathy to those who are struggling in their internal debate of how do we pursue justice without sacrificing unity. Thank you.
I was going to say, before Dr. Keaney began her lecture and forgot to say, that she spent 13 or 14 years living in Cairo prior to founding Westmont in Istanbul. Knowing the global emphasis of tonight's presentation, Dr. Marianne Robbins arranged to be born in France. She has her PhD from the Sorbonne and is also a member of the history faculty and was the co-leader of Westmont's Mediterranean semester. Dr. Robbins.
As a preface to my remarks, I want to say what this is and what this isn't. This is a response to Dr. Keeney's first version of this paper that was morphed in the last hour or so. So when I say implicitly, it means that it was written here, but it disappeared today. And when I say explicitly, it means that it wasn't in the paper, but it appeared here. Make sense? Okay. But the arguments are the same, so. Well, first of all, I would like to thank Dr. Keaney as a fellow medievalist for her contribution to the study of early Muslim political thought. It's not an easy field, and we need more people to be engaged in that field. So I'm just kind of calling on you to become medieval Muslim historians. But Dr. Keaney faced the difficult task of connecting a political thought that was developed in one context, a pre-modern society, to contemporary concerns that have emerged in a radically different context. And I believe she has successfully helped us understand how an old Muslim trope, the tension between unity and justice, or obedience and chaos, has continued to play out in recent times. Finally, Dr. Keaney has implicitly reminded us how easy it is to condemn people who fail to rebel against tyranny when your nation has not experienced the devastation of civil war in so long. How easy it is to point out to the terrorism of terrorists while turning a blind eye to the atrocities committed by established governments. I have two different sets of questions, one stemming from the medievalist in me, the other from the somewhat informed observer of recent political developments in the Muslim world. As a medievalist, I wonder about the word justice, as it was used by Muslim scholars in the context of Uthman's murder. What exactly does it mean that Uthman's opponent removed him for the sake of justice? I'm going to flesh that out a little bit. Explicitly, we are told how Uthman was a bad ruler. But was nepotism such a bad thing in Islam? Because certainly in the medieval West, it was common practice. That's what you do. Of course you put your family members in power. And how is this vision of bad leadership grounded in the context of its time? In other words, sometimes I got the sense that there was bad leadership, universal bad leadership, bad government. But bad governments are not always the same. It doesn't mean the same thing to be a bad leader in medieval Islam and to be a bad leader today in a nation state of Egypt. So how did this idea of good and bad government change through time as it reflected different contexts? Second, you insisted on the notion of justice as an important reason to oppose a tyrant. But how did early Muslim understand justice exactly? I think the term is not self-evident to us. Was it closely related to the notion of justice that was later developed in the political model of the circle of justice? But since I heard of the circle of justice from Dr. Keaney herself, I didn't know about it earlier, it might be that this question is more of a coffee shop question for obsessive medievalists, in which case, let's plan on meeting at Starbucks very soon. As a somewhat informed observer of international politics, I could not help but notice the strong relevance of the opposition between stability, even at the price of tyranny, and anarchy. Several dictators have been removed from power in recent years, and we could think here of Saddam Hussein or Gaddafi, yet both areas are in a state of civil war and chaos. Have Muslim scholars commented on this as well? Is the chaos created by the French and American interventions in other countries another proof for Muslim scholars that tyranny is preferable to fitna? Also, I realize that Dr. Keaney dealt here only with one trope of political thought in Islam. There are probably many others, but what your presentation did well is remind us that the Muslim world hardly speaks with one voice on political issues. And perhaps you can help us understand other historical traditions that have grounded other political positions in Islam. Finally, I wonder, and that's more a question for all of us, I wonder how Dr. Keaney's talk might help us examine more closely political concepts and assumptions we hold about both the Muslim world and our own context. And I'll take two examples. First, terrorism. The word evokes strong emotional reactions and for good reasons. Yet, would it be helpful to think about our use of the word terrorism as a term that applies exclusively to particular groups, such as ISIS? Is it fair to reserve the term terrorist to organizations that publicize their horrific violence, while state violence, because it remains hidden from us, seems somehow less horrific. So is, in other words, terrorism connected to publicity rather than to actions themselves? Second, I would like for us to reconsider our use of the term safety. As we think about the stability and peace we enjoy in this country, could we be more aware that this peace is parceled out unequally? And that while many of us do not have to worry about violence, some of us do not take safety for granted and live in a very different world. Could we consider that in some parts of this country, gun violence has created a state that at times borders on fitna? Thank you.
Dr. Charles Farhadian is professor of world religions and Christian mission. When it comes to world religions, he wrote the book. Introducing World Religions, A Christian Engagement has received fantastic endorsements. And he's also written Christianity, Islam, and Nationalism in Indonesia. He's spent major amounts of time in Indonesia and Papua New Guinea. Dr. Farhadian.
Hi, nice to see you all. This is the first Phi Kappa Phi I've been to, so they only gave me 30 minutes. But thank you, Professor Keaney. Joe, great to see you. I want to tell you about my book. Did I tell you I was born? Okay. Thank you very much, Professor Keaney. Where are you? Thank you so much. That was so insightful and a lot to ponder, and like Professor Robbins mentioned, some of your comments are a little bit different than the paper, but that's fine. The substance was there. I will try to keep my comments to about 7 to 10 minutes, okay? First, it's important to recognize the multifaceted motivations for the revolt and the assassination of Uthman. Uthman's murder was based not only on immoral behavior such as nepotism, financial corruption, the divergence from the Prophet on some of the religious and political matters, but also because of his innovation. Innovation sounds like a virtue to Western ears, but in Islam, innovation refers to a new thing that opposes the Quran and the tradition of the Prophet. It's something that is against Islam, tantamount to heterodoxy. So Uthman was an innovator in a pejorative sense of that term. But the motivation for Uthman's demise may have included territorial considerations. Uthman's murder was more than a victory for disgruntled Muslims in Egypt. His assassination meant the triumph of the periphery of the Muslim world, because his death led to the permanent shift of the imperial center of gravity away from Medina, where he was killed, out of the Arabian Peninsula into the Fertile Crescent, that is Kufa, about 100 miles south of Baghdad. And Kufa became the center of the Islamic administration. So beyond real politic, moral, and economic failings, territorial ambitions may need to be included. Second, there's a challenge to understand the meaning of an authentic Islamic government, both in Islamic history as well as for today. What is authentic lies at the heart of much of the tension within the Muslim world today, determining the legitimacy or illegitimacy of a Muslim leader is the first step to a response that may result in anything from issuing a religious opinion against the ruler or the ruler's expulsion through murder. The paper notes that the murder of Uthman, quote, marked the end of the religio-political balance established by Muhammad and inaugurated the debate over and quest for authentic Islamic government. It was the end of Islam as both religion and state. This wrenching apart of religion from politics happened early on in Islamic history and remains a significant point of contention and debate among Muslims worldwide today. By the way, I've never been to Egypt. My work has been in Indonesia, so Islam in Southeast Asia has some unique features that makes it distinct from Islam in the Middle East or Africa or elsewhere. It's not surprising that the schools of Islamic law first appeared in local centers, Basra, Kufa, Medina, Damascus, reflecting diversity in interpretation. Al-Shafi'i, an 8th century jurist who was the first to suggest systematizing Islamic jurisprudence, stated, quote, "Every capital of the Muslims is a seat of learning whose people follow the opinion of one of their countrymen in most of his teachings." He goes on to mention local authorities in Mecca, Basra, Kufa, and Syria. They all follow their own doctrines, living traditions, living sunnah, in the absence of strict rules of law, like those elaborated later by the 4 Islamic law schools. Ascertaining the criteria for authenticity raises immediate questions, since by trying to determine what is authentic government in Islam, we see that the Quran and the Sunnah lend themselves to different interpretations. Without a magisterium, that is, an ultimate authority that oversees the tradition, there are a range of Muslim responses that all claim to represent Islamic orthodoxy on the subject. Thus, for instance, there are huge differences between Muslims of Pakistan, Indonesia, Saudi Arabia, and the UK on the question of authenticity. And all faithful Muslims would base their understanding of authenticity on the Quran and Sunnah. Most scholars interpret that the Medinan community, the one that Uthman was a member of, formed a total framework for state, culture, religion, and society. According to John Esposito, the Medinan ideal, quote, "constituted the challenge for the Islamic community throughout much of its history. It inspired Muhammad to transform a local sheikhdom into a trans-tribal state." Yet the modern state is a different kind of social and political grouping than a sheikhdom or a tribal state writ large. This takes me to my third point about nationalism and Islamic identity. Professor Keaney's paper reminds us of the challenge of Islam in a modern nation state that seeks both unity and plurality. That is, unity of its people while being inclusive of its multiple minority citizens. The al-Azhar Declaration in Support of the Arab Revolution, which she mentioned, upholds a Quranic view of justice and unity. The declaration even offers conditions whereby a tyrannical leader can be ousted, quote, if the people have the ability to do so, end quote, if there is no possibility of damage and harm to the nation.
Charlie.
Yes.
Okay.
So the emphasis is on unity, and Professor Keaney rightly said that in the context of disunity. But I wanted to raise in this, and I don't have time to complete this thought, but the idea that, or the question of how do you deal with religious minorities in these nations? That's the question I wanted to raise. A few other questions. What about the spiritual interpretations that we might bring to bear on the motivation for or the interpretations of the demise of an unjust Muslim leader? Here I'm talking about baraka, the blessing, because baraka in at least Southeast Asian Islam is a blessing that even presidents, secular presidents in Muslim countries receive, and it gives them the power to rule justly. And even in modern Southeast Asian political discourse, if there's a demise of that president, that Muslim president, there's a sense that the baraka, the blessing of God, has been taken from that. So I want to know, and I don't know enough about the, you know, and this is really, I'll defer to you, but is there some sense of baraka or spiritual blessing that's been withdrawn from Uthman that actually led to his demise? What is the relationship between fitna and faith? It's illuminating to read that Uthman knew about his impending assassination and, quote, sacrificed himself in an effort to preserve the unity of the community. He became a martyr. Was Uthman an exemplar of submission? How might other Muslim leaders, especially those who failed to uphold Islamic justice, rationalize their demise through a similar logic of sacrifice and martyrdom? Depending on one's interpretation of the events, one could very well see that Uthman was faithful to the very end. And the final question, which we don't have time to explore, is I'd like to hear a little bit more about the notion of the common good, particularly in terms of the role of religious and ethnic minorities in these large Muslim states. Thank you very much.
Dr. Keaney has a chance to respond to her response.
Okay. Thank you for those remarks, detailed and expansive, which will give me hopefully an opportunity to make some of the points that I cut. So yay for this arrangement. I appreciate that certainly there are rebellion against Uthman is multifactorial. And that tribal affiliations, regional power balances, innovations all come together. And I was merely pulling out one narrative strand and seeing where it leads that I feel the chroniclers develop. But it is certainly not the only one. If you're really interested in medieval historiography, we could talk about the ways in which chroniclers are engaged in internal debates and the ways in which they're becoming more historically sophisticated by the types of causes they're willing to bring into the mix. But, so thank you, Dr. Farhadi. There are certainly many causes that appear in the chronicles. I'm merely taking one. In terms of, I've not heard of Beraka being used in the Middle East to bless a ruler, have you? No. So that's really fascinating to me. Just in terms of what I've been looking at most recently, Azhar scholars who defended Mubarak was simply, he is the legitimate ruler, and it seems more like because he's the ruler, he therefore must be legitimate. God knows. So but again, now that I teach world history, it actually reminds me kind of a mandate of heaven, right? This idea that once you're in power, the system is there to support you. Once you're overthrown, there's nothing for you. You know, that successfully shows that you are no longer God's chosen. So there's a sense of responding to events, and I think certainly we could engage more with these Azhar declarations of the way they are also responding to events and putting a principled gloss on a clear, you know, which way is the wind blowing at the moment. But anyway, little diversion. I think in terms of, and also this idea of the religious, and maybe kind of where Dr. Farhadian and Dr. Robbins' comments overlap, is what is justice and how, so that Uthman's abuses were religious innovations, changing how he prayed, consolidating the Quran, meaning burning variant readings of the Quran. So you could say, yay, consolidating the Quran, or ooh, burning the Quran. Like, it's open to interpretation. But what is justice? In my understanding, I think one of the things that gets Uthman into trouble is not that nepotism per se is a problem, but that by appointing family members to key government posts, what Uthman was doing was saying tribal identity trumps Islamic identity. And that he was appointing these people not because they had precedence in Islam, not because they had converted early, not because they'd been with Muhammad in the dark days, but simply because they were his family members. And this was kind of the Gordian knot that Islam had to cut. It had to be the new super tribe that surpassed all tribal loyalties. And there's a sense in which I think, though again, we don't know because our earliest sources are from several hundred years later. So again, what Uthman did and why it mattered, I think, as I tried to indicate, is in part constructed not just in terms of what were the actual historical causes, but very much what were the known historical consequences. And I think that was also kind of where I was wanting to put my emphasis and how that colored the narrative. In terms of good and bad government, I think what we see in the Islamic period is that the centrality of law becomes the measure. Does the ruler support Sharia and the ways in which Islamic law as rulers seem to become further and further away from the model of Muhammad, as they seem to become more dictatorial, authoritarian, decadent. Where is the check? Where, what keeps us kind of tethered to this ideal age of Muhammad? We could try overthrowing the ruler, but we've done that. And the next ruler turns out to be Kelsapries, not much better than the previous one. So let's find another way, Islamic law. Let's just kind of take the whole thing out of the government's hands. The jurists will be the arbiters, and they will advise the government, try to check the government, develop concepts like bari to limit it. But that this is where justice and good government, and that the ruler's job is to listen to religious scholars, give them positions that enable them to do their job, but that there should be, again, maybe very similar to, again, I'm not a medieval Europeanist, but this kind of combination between church and state, that there's a combination between mosque and state, that they have mutually beneficial and complementary roles. And we see this in the modern period where, again, in Sunni Islam, Shia Islam is very different, but in Sunni Islam, the goal is not to put a particular person in the seat of president. That is not where the action is. The ruler is not gonna do it. What you want is law, which is why if you've heard of Sharia or Islamic law, but haven't heard of particular Sunni politicians, there's a reason for that. It's because the law and who upholds it and defends it is what's going to measure whether this government is legitimate, just, good. And again, I think that could be further unpacked, but I think the centrality of Islamic law as kind of a way to do damage control for tyranny is this enduring dimension.